Wonder presents this recording of The Cattle King, written by Ion Idriess.
It was nearly dawn, though dark and cold in the loft. A rat squeaked and scuttled along a rafter. The boy shivered. He detested rats. He was rolling a tiny swag, just a threadbare rug and towel. He did the job neatly, strapping the folds tightly. Then stood in shirt and trousers, worn boots, and a battered felt hat that quite hid his wavy brown hair. He listened, his brown eyes serious. Barely 13, yet determination showed on that childish face. Not a sound. He clutched his pocket. Yes, it was there. 5 shillings. All the money he had in the world. He crept down from the loft to a horse, tied under a tree outside. Quietly, he led it across the yard and out the gate. With a lump in his throat, he shook his bridle rein and rode away into the dawn. It was early in 1870, and the world this boy knew was a small place indeed, but he felt sure there was a great world farther out, beyond the barrier range across the border of New South Wales. Out there, somewhere, Big Brother George was working on a new cattle station. Beyond the barrier, he vaguely sensed there were great areas of country that knew not the white man. A country out past the farthest limits of the sheepmen and the cattlemen. Surely there must be room for him out there. The sun brightened the crowns of the lovely Adelaide Hills. He was riding north, leaving the young city behind. The deeply rutted Kapunda Road, hedged with its gums and rolling downs and vales, stretched before him. Smoke now was rising from the chimneys of the farmhouses. The fresh air was sweeter for the call of birds. The sun warmed the stiff old bones of the horse that answered so willingly to the softly voiced encouragement of the boy. Good old Cyclops. A lad who went to school had assured him that Cyclops was a one-eyed giant who could run faster than a racehorse. He had no breakfast, but he didn't mind. No lunch either, though he was hungry when he rode over the Gawler Bridge. Proudly, he rode through the street of the bright little town, its stone houses pretty with gardens and trees foretelling prosperity to a growing agricultural district. He rode on into the country with its low, grassy slopes, its level fields, its dark green paddocks of gum falling rapidly, alas, to the axe. Every mile was of interest. His quick eye and mind missed nothing. Across the paddocks and hills on both sides of the road, men were working. Horses were pulling at plough, or cart, or wagon. Constantly passing him were buggies and wagonettes, dray or wagonette carting produce to the hungry young city. All the vehicles were pulled by horses or bullocks. What a market for horses and bullocks must exist in this district. He rode eagerly on, his education already commenced. Just at sundown, he saw the roofs of Kapunda gleaming above the trees some miles ahead. Then he rode down among the little hills and emerged to see lights twinkling like a welcome through the gloom. Old Cyclops had done remarkably well, 50 miles that day. He put up at the Prince of Wales Hotel. Before he dined, he made sure that Cyclops was enjoying a good meal in a warm stall. Next morning, he paid his bill. 1 shilling for dinner, 1 shilling for bed, 1 shilling for breakfast, 1 shilling for Cyclops. He mounted and rode away, 1 shilling left in his pocket, and not a worry in his head. Soon, he turned off on the road that leads to the borough. That day, he passed some fine teams hauling copper from the Burra mines to Port Adelaide and estimated the capacity and value of each team. Late that afternoon, Cyclops showed signs of knocking up. Dismounting, the boy led the old horse. He had to nurse it. With one shilling, it represented his fortune. Cyclops was the first animal he'd ever owned, and he loved it. Sundown came, and in the chilly dusk, Sid walked on, leading his horse, feeling lonely and hungry. Presently, he saw the twinkle of a fire, and hopefully turned from the road shadows. Cyclops pricked his ears and sniffed the smoke. It was a mule camp near Black Springs, and a roughly clad man was just lifting the billy off. He glanced up at the boy's approach.
Good evening, lad.
Good evening, mister.
You come far?
No, from Kapunda. My horse knocked up.
Well, better turn him out. Then come and have something to eat.
Thanks.
You come from Adelaide Way?
Yeah.
Bit any rain down there?
Not for the last few miles, but there's plenty of good feed around the hills.
You heard anything of Big John Forrest?
No. He's an explorer, isn't he?
Yeah, one of the best. He left Perth about 5 months ago with his brother Alexander and a party to try and come overland to Adelaide.
Is it far?
Oh, about 1,500 miles or more by the route he may take.
Do you think he'll do it?
Sure. Neither bush nor desert nor distance can beat Big John.
You seem to like him.
Every Western Australian does.
How many people are there in Western Australia?
Oh, only 25,000, but they'll come. They'll come. If only they could find gold, as they have in Victoria, there wouldn't be enough ships to carry the men there.
These explorers must be great men.
Oh, they are. They go out to those deserts, wild blacks, plains or mountains ahead of them. They're lost to the world until they return, and if they fail, well, there's no help for them. They blaze the way, the pioneers follow, and we follow the pioneers.
The boy was a willing listener while the man talked. His shrewd questions drew willing replies. After breakfast next morning, he saddled Cyclops and then turned to his friend with a shilling in his hand, a smile on his face.
Thank you very much, mister. I'm sorry, it's all I have.
Ah, you're welcome, my lad. Keep the money, you'll need it.
Years later, the boy sought this man who so nicely refused his shilling. He never found him. Burra Township had been busy under the copper boom ever since Pickett, the shepherd, found copper in 1845. Prosperous shops, the long street alive with horse and bullock teams, horsemen riding by, miners thronging in from the mines, a drover coming in with a mob of cattle. Burra was the then terminus of the railway, just completed from Adelaide. This township, with its atmosphere of future growth, was far more interesting than a storybook to the restless eyes of the boy. Slowly, he rode through the town, impressing its business on his mind, trying to gauge its future possibilities. The activities here obviously used many horses and bullocks. Someday, he might sell this town horses and cattle. With a deep breath, he rode on, his serious brown eyes lending thoughtfulness to his face. He wanted to find a job, quickly. A job farther out, where he could grow as the country grew. It was at a roadside hotel at Old Mount Bryan that he met Harry Russ and Charlie Hames. They'd come from Mundy Mundy Station to the Burra for rations and were about to return. The boy had met them months ago at the Adelaide sale yards when they'd come down with a mob of Mundy Mundy cattle.
Where to, young fella?
My brother at the barrier.
What, George? You've got a long ride ahead of you.
I'll get there. Do Do you know where he is?
Yeah, he's at Poolamacca Station somewhere with a droving plant. You can come along with us if you like.
Thanks. I'd be pleased.
Hey, where'd you get that horse?
I bought him.
You'll never make a horse dealer, lad.
You'll never reach Poolamacca on that old bag of bones. You should have sold him to the boneyard.
Anyway, you take your swag across to our dray over there and keep an eye on our horses. Now, we'll be along presently and you can come onto the barrier with us. And you give us your horse and we'll see if we can get him a feed.
Thanks very much.
His two friends took the old horse across to the hotel and there sold it for 10 shillings, which they promptly drank. When the boy realised what had happened, he stared across at the rough bush pub, cold fury mingling with the tears in his eyes.
I'll never drink, so help me God I won't.
When they did move on, his job was to drive the spare horses plodding along behind the ration dray. Here he immediately made friends with the dog. Day by day, they plodded out into the real bush, the farming lands now left behind. This was the land of stations, the homesteads gradually appearing at longer and longer distances apart. Slow travelling in those days. Quickly the boy learned to make a damper, to boil a billy without smoking the water, to find the horses in the early dawn. Day by day, as he walked on behind the dray, his roaming eyes were memorizing the country with a memory that had not faded 60 years later. It was a labor of love. The birds, the trees, the grasses, the hills, the scarce waterholes, the very air of the bush, he felt was his. As day by day they journeyed farther north, the boy noticed the country changing. There were no running creeks here. The only water was in isolated brown holes. They passed through the mallee belt, then out onto plain country, and were in the land of the sparse rainfall. The boy gazed upon a dull, grey carpet stretching far away. He'd never seen saltbush before. At night, from the two men smoking as they yarned, sprawled out on their blankets beside the fire, the boy quietly learnt all they knew of the bush and of the men and the stock and the country farther out. One day there slowly formed before them, far away out across a grey saltbush plain that stretched across the New South Wales border, the harsh grey outline of the Barrier Range. And one sundown, to the barking of dogs, they drove up to the roughly built homestead of Mundi Mundi. This meant journey's end for Hames and the horses. Next morning, after a yarn with the manager, Harry came to the boy.
Your luck's dead in, young'un. I've got to ride across to Poolamacca with a message for the boss. Your brother is working somewhere near the new station, so you can come along with me.
Thanks.
Charlie says he'll lend you his mare. You better go and see him about it, and then go and ask for some rations from the cook.
Poolamacca Station was 60 miles farther along in the Barrier Range. Harry and the boy followed a shortcut, which soon faded into a faint pad, winding ever deeper in among the hills. As they rode from the red gums along the big dry creeks, cockatoos and galahs rose in shrieking protest. The boy's delight was brought suddenly to earth as Harry reined in.
Hold hard, Sid. We'll have a drink. My coppers are burning. Catch the pack horse.
You're right, Harry. Here, boy. Oh, the water bag's still hanging round his neck. The cork's out. The bag's dry.
Hot as the hobs of Hades, too. Well, there's water in the creek just ahead. We'd better push on.
But there was no water in the creek, nor in the next. The creeks of the Barrier Range are large, sandy creeks lined with red gums, carrying running water only during heavy rain. Some held a waterhole at intervals of miles apart, otherwise the beds were broad stretches of shingle and hot sand. By
midday. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.